You know, I appreciate that attitude. And I've got my eyes on you, but you're not quiet. We have security. The concert, we actually aren't starting. I came out to tell you we're not starting yet. What I want to do before we start up the first piece is to talk to you about it, give you a chance to sing some of the themes from it, that sort of thing. So Superman is the opening piece. Roger Hatberg is the MC, and he'll tell you more about John Williams in a bit. And yeah, we are a little bit early, but I want to be able to just come out and play this piece and not talk about it. But every piece, I wrote this little sticky note that I put in there, and I use these initials, W-M-I-S. And when I remember what those initials mean, it's what makes it special. What is cool about this piece? You know, on the opening of Superman, let's change the order a little bit at A. Let's do the driving rhythmic accompaniment. So here then. Two. That rhythmic motif is really what ties this thing together. And Derek, if you play the tune at the fast level. Good. But on the opening fanfare, here's what Derek does. Can I beat this at the fast tempo and you play in the slow? Two, three. That didn't work, but anyway. No, let us try that one again. Let's try it again. To show I'm more professionals here. Let me beat it. Let's talk about it a little bit. One. Dum, ba, dum, ba. There we go. Two, three, four. This is the opening fanfare. Do you recognize it? Yes, the same thing. Okay, thank you. What's the other spot? 67. This is kind of the love theme from Superman. Is that the right spot? Yeah, let's hear the people that have that tune here. This love theme. Three. So how does he accompany that? You know, what's he going to do that's really different? Here's what he does. It's the same thing. He uses that same figure, and that ties the entire piece together. Consider yourselves enlightened, and now we're going to go.
What there is to say, you know? Anyway, good evening and welcome to your 2017 inaugural concert of the Southeast Iowa Symphony Orchestra. It's the Pops concert. And remember now, this is the inaugural concert. There are still three more main concerts and the Kids Symphony this season. We're glad you're here to enjoy this program. And didn't you enjoy the food? That was great. As well, to show that the symphony is having an even greater outreach, we have several groups who are here tonight who have purchased the entire table. We have Lorraine Williams from Washington and her table, Bill and Carol Couples, and their table from Macomb, and Mike Brockman, and his table from Fort Madison, and Bob has even brought some of his friends. I know he doesn't have too many, but at least he managed to get those here tonight. We welcome you all. We also want to recognize the major sponsors for tonight's event, Bloody Chapel, Proved Healing Funeral Home, and Zeiser's Landscaping, Floral, and Greenhouse. Those are the folks who are responsible for the biggest bulk of tonight's performance. So we certainly thank those three groups. As you know, tonight's theme is Music of the Movies, a tribute to John Williams, an incredible composer, not just in the film industry, but also in the orchestral literature as well. Tonight, the orchestra will feature some of the most memorable and even a few hidden gems from the catalog of John Williams. Now, even before the advent of the talkies in the 1920s, Music was an integral part of any motion picture experience. Pianists, organists, and even orchestras were employed to accompany the visual images on the screen. It was improvised, in the case of the organists and the pianists, or it was actually composed to complement the orchestral versions. But with the advent of Al Jolson in the film The Jazz Singer, recorded music became an absolutely indispensable part of the movie experience. Now, of course, you know, I always have to have a question, that's the academic in me, but who was the man responsible for acting, directing, producing, even composing music for some of his films? If you know who that person was, you get a big hand, that's it. Anyway, but enough about that. Let's bring Bob Mcconnell back to lead the Southeast Iowa Symphony Orchestra in a bunch of new, wonderful things.
Thank you.
from that 1978 film. John Williams, a New Yorker, was raised primarily in New York and then in California, but returned to New York to study at the Juilliard School. He was a piano major, and he studied with Rosa Levine, and then composition at the Eastman School. When he graduated in the early 50s, he joined the U.S. Air Force, where he arranged music for and conducted the Air Force Band. Following those military years, he returned to the Los Angeles area, where he worked as a studio musician, a jazz pianist, but came to the attention of Henry Mancini, and it was because of Mancini's thematic music that John Williams arranged for the TV series Peter Gunn that brought him some early success. He also was nominated for an Academy Award for Days of Wine and Roses. I know many of you remember that show. As well as Charade, and then of course the disaster films, Earthquake, Poseidon Adventure, all of that sort of stuff. But anyway, he ultimately, I lost the rest of my notes, we'll fake it from here, right, Bob?
It's kind of tough when you're standing on crutches up there.
Oh, hush up.
Yeah,
found it. Anyway, such films as Valley of the Dolls and Goodbye, Mr. Chips, and he received his first Oscar for scoring the film score to Fiddler on the Roof. I never knew that. I always thought it was, you know, the same guy who did the Broadway show, did it. No, Williams took all that music and scored it for the film. And who can't forget that two-note theme from 1975 Jaws? I mean, even Bachman couldn't get away with anything less than that, no?
And he felt that piece was a little too difficult to program.
Oh. Oh, not too difficult to conduct, though, right?
No.
Okay, anyway, he's been nominated over 50 times. 50 times for Academy Awards. He is superseded only by Walt Disney. He's won 5, and he's been awarded 6 Emmys, 25 Golden Globes, and 67 Grammys. Now, it's amazing with this guy. He's also composed music for the Olympics, one of which we'll hear tonight. That's the 1988 Korean Games. But he also did 84, 96, 2002, and I read that he had been commissioned to write the music for the 2018 Olympics in Seoul, South Korea. So, anyway, if that were not enough, he succeeded Arthur Fiedler, the founder of the Boston Pops, and remains to this day the emeritus conductor. So, enough about Williams. It's the music we're here to do, right? So, Bob, you can take it away with Angela's Ashes?
Well, I know many people think they're here for music, but we're gonna interrupt the concert for a literature reading.
See, you never know what you're gonna get from Maestro Bob, huh?
Frank McCourt wrote this autobiography of a miserable childhood, and it became immensely popular. Williams did the music for the movie, which I was completely unaware of until I was doing the program in the summer. Frank McCourt writes at the beginning of his book, "My father and mother should have stayed in New York where they met and married and where I was born. Instead, they returned to Ireland when I was 4. My brother Malachi, 3, the twins, Oliver, barely 1, and my sister Margaret, dead and gone. When I look back on my childhood, I wonder how I survived it all. It was, of course, a miserable childhood. The happy childhood's hardly worth your while. Worse than the ordinary miserable childhood is a miserable Irish childhood, and worse yet is a miserable Irish Catholic childhood. People everywhere brag and whimper about the woes of their early years, but nothing can compare with the Irish person. The poverty, the shiftless, loquacious, alcoholic father, the pious, defeated mother moaning by the fire, pompous priests, bullying schoolmasters, the English, and the terrible things they did to us for 800 long years. So you are in for some happy music here." So, what makes this special? Margie, play this opening melody and listen to how he lays this melody out. So he sticks these, go ahead, Marcia. He sticks these big leaps in there, ba-da, ba-da-da, and back and forth, and it's just a beautiful, plaintive tune. Now, a little later in the piece, I like to say this movement features both the piano, the harp, and the principal oboe. Our principal oboe is visiting tonight. Emily Hart is the new oboe teacher at Western Illinois. And it's so nice to have a venue that we can bring these people in and it's a wonderful player. But I want you to hear a little of what else makes this special right here with the harp. What's called the celeste. It kind of sounds like some chimes, and they're in unison with the harp. I know many of you don't care. You're welcome to go to sleep while I'm saying this. The other thing Williams does that endears himself to the string players is he writes lines like this. String players love these kind of parts. No, this is what makes them want to kill Williams. He writes this beautiful lyric, but hard, difficult, fast notes underneath. This is the theme for Mansfield's Ashes. That piece was actually quite difficult for me to conduct, as I had such a miserable childhood myself. I got distracted a lot during the piece. My brother's here tonight from Seattle, and he can tell you how miserable we were. Poor Scotch-Irish pig farmers we were. So the next piece actually isn't from a movie. Olympic Spirit was the NBC kind of main motive for the Korean Games. And it's, again, he makes use of that driving motif, this time primarily in the snare drum. But we're going to take a spot 44 here, Orchestra, and show you how he divides it. He divides the winds and the strings into three different choirs and then the snare. And it's interesting to hear it broken apart. Good. Here's group two without the other. Makes you get up and want to march. But this third section is really interesting rhythmically, what he does. So these little fanfares. And it's a group too. He puts the piano, the bells, the flute, and the horn together. And then we have our poor snare drum. It's so dull, but if he gets off, everybody notices. Here's what the four groups sound like together. Pickups. Okay. That's it. Olympic Spirit. Thank you. So the next set of pieces, we're going to do four of the eight Harry Potter Sorcerer's Stone suite pieces. And what John Williams said that he did with this was he took the film score and he was really, go ahead, I'm not taking my coat off for nothing. People are so fearful, especially when I have this robe on, that they don't want to approach. But he got inspired to write this suite where he takes eight movements and he assigns different instruments. We're going to do four of them. So the first one is based on Harry Potter's owl. Now I know a lot of you are way too old to have ever seen or heard of Harry Potter. But if you haven't, it's good for anybody. Believe me, it really, the movies, the books, it's all great. So how is he going to capture the spirit of this owl? He uses that celeste sound again. And Margie, can you play that opening thing? So again, he decides, hey, why don't I torture the strings? And I'll throw in the celeste too. So here's what they have. Let's go right at 43 again, strings. But this is violins and cello. I love hearing that. You know what that sound means to me? I've got good players. That's what it means. I watched John Williams on YouTube talk about the next piece, Fluffy and His Harp. In the Sorcerer's Stone, there's a three-headed monster dog that guards a trap door, and a magic harp plays. So what John Williams did here was he wrote a duet for a contrabassoon and a harp. And I really wanted to feature this, even though I've got a bunch of other people sitting around up here, because the contra player gets ripped off so often. They don't have great parts. We are lucky to have a player that went out and bought his own instrument, and I think you'll enjoy his impersonation of a snoring dog. So in the Harry Potter story, there's a place where all the wizards go for their supplies, and it's called Diagon Alley. And it reminds me of kind of that first bar scene in Star Trek where you walk in and there's these crazy creatures. This is the same kind of effect, that he has a group of soloists here. Charlene gets to play kind of the witch's solo on the violin. We have a solo viola, solo cello, a bunch of solo percussionists, and then who else do we have? Is that it, pretty much? Oh, the woodwinds. Yeah, we have a bunch of woodwinds that are kind of the main traveling party holding this thing together. And the place is called Diagon Alley, the Wizard's Shopping Mall. I do want you to hear a couple of things in the percussion when I say what makes this special. Jenny, why don't you do your part first, right there, 69. So she's on a set of bells. She's being accompanied by pitched tom-tom drums. And Scott, you're on marimba? Yeah, or what? And when you put the three of those together, this is a pretty crazy sound. And a little later, you'll hear Jenny play with some of the antique bells for them. They look like little finger cymbals. They're on a stick, and she hits the bells. So it's pretty similar to metal mallet, but it has a little different ring. This is Diagon.
Thank you.
So the final movement, what William said he did was take everything from the Sorcerer's Stone and put it into one piece. Again, when I look at this movement and say, what makes it unique? That last movement is actually pretty interesting to pick out 1,000 unique things. But partway through this, at bar 69 orchestra, let's divide it a little further. Here's what the harp has, where he tries to create this just oral sensation of something magical going on. That's the harp. At the same time, the piano, percussion, and flute, here's what they have. Okay, then the third group is the vibraphone, oboe, horn, clarinet, violas, and cello. Groups together, and then the melody comes in after that. Here's what it sounds like. Isn't that amazing? How can he sit around and decide, these are the sounds I'm going to put together for this? This is the final movement, Harry's Wondrous World. We will have an intermission after this piece. Back near the door, there's a table to sign up for the Friends group and to give donations to the orchestra. We appreciate anything you can give us that helps support the mission as we go out to the schools and communities. Harry's Wondrous World.
Thank you.
You know, I was expecting him to have a little trick and some firework coming out of that job. And anyway, we're going to take about a 15-minute break, then come back with some singers and more of music of John Williams. See you in 15. Exciting music, and we have even more for you coming up. But these sorts of affairs do not happen by themselves. And we'd like to recognize at this time the 2017 Pops Planning Committee. So as I call their names, if you all would please stand. Mariana Brink, Suzanne Brick, Joanne Bauer, she's up here, Kate Conrad, Lisa Jettison, Debbie Jotums, Susan Moss, and Roxy Reeson. And also we'd like to recognize John Dodge. He's the Symphony Board Treasurer, and he has helped a lot over the years for these Pops concerts. Let's give those folks a big hand. Now, you know, I mentioned at the beginning that this is the inaugural concert, so be sure you're around in October for the first symphony concert featuring Spencer Meyer. I think this is Spencer's third appearance with Southeast Iowa Symphony, a fabulous pianist, and he's doing the Beethoven Fourth Concerto. If you've never heard it, you have missed out a lot. So be sure you're at Capitol Theater on the 21st of October to hear Spencer. Also, the winter concert featuring the resident violinist. She will be in the area for 2 weeks prior. And in the spring concert, we have, it's all French, Debussy, Ravel, and the Saint-Saëns Requiem Mass. It will be conducted by Blair, Buffington, professor of choral activities at Iowa Wesleyan, who has also prepared the choir. I thought they were going to be on, but they're not on. Anyway, so be sure you're around. It's an exciting season with lots of variety. So, I would like now for Joanne and Bob to come out. Joanne has a presentation for the orchestra for Bob.
Hi, I want to thank this wonderful, this is Joanne Bauer, the president of the Southeast Iowa Symphony Friends.
He is a wonderful conductor, and we have a wonderful symphony orchestra. And I want you all to give a big hello! Come on, let's hear it. The Friends is an organization here in Burlington that we want to support, but we do support the symphony orchestra. And so, as a thing today, this evening, instead of having the auction or the raffle, we have donations. And so we decided just to do that and let you all visit with each other during the intermission. And we would like you all, of course, to support the Friends. So we're giving Bob this wonderful little plaque. I can't get by without a little help from my friends, right? And a check for $3,500.
Thank you, Jordan. Thanks for all of us. You know, folks, the Friends do an awful lot of stuff for the orchestra. They work behind the scenes. The most visible thing you see is tonight, but they're constantly working to come up with ideas to help support the orchestra and its cultural endeavor. So, are you ready for more music? Bob has that look in his eye like I have no clue what he's going to say. I'll just turn it over to him. We're going to hear Raiders, march from Raiders of the Lost Ark, 1981. Take it away, Bob.
When I ask myself what makes this piece special, I can't really tell you. It's just, I told the orchestra, I feel embarrassed, but when we start playing this and the first tune comes in, it just raises the hair on my neck. It's just such a cool tune. Which reminds me, I asked Joanne before we went out, I said, have you been drinking?
For the next few numbers, we're going to be joined by the Southeast Iowa Symphony Chorus. These singers are made up of singers from Burlington's Bel Canto, Iowa Wesleyan University singers, the Mt.Pleasant Choral, and a group from Ottumwa. They come together on fairly short notice to provide an ancillary part to our concert experience. As I mentioned earlier, they're going to be featured also in the Sassoon Requiem in the March concert. They're all prepared by Blair Buffington, professor of choral activities at Iowa Wesleyan University. Is Blair back there? Is he singing?
Blair's actually going to conduct this piece.
He's going to conduct? Okay. Yeah. Anyway, we're going to hear three pieces. The Hymn for the Fallen from Saving Private Ryan, Dry Your Tears from Amistad, and Duel of the Fates from The Phantom Menace. Ooh, hardly wait. All right, let's welcome Blair to the podium. Bob, are you going to say a
piece? Yeah, I'll introduce the piece a little bit, and then I'll have Blair.
Okay, very well.
So what makes this piece special? Well, part of it is that it's one of, Williams said himself, one of his biggest challenges is the solemnity of the scene of the American graves, the cemeteries in France. And this is the music that honors that. And he wanted to use chorus, but he didn't want words to interfere with the mood. So you hear the chorus singing, but they're really just a part of the orchestra at this point. It's the different ranges, and he uses them as an instrument. A couple of the things he does that are so cool and unique on this. Well, let's just hear what the percussion had at the beginning. Combination of timpani and snare, this just sets the mood. But then he has this really unique call between two trumpets and two flutes. Here's what the first flute and the first trumpet have. Here's what the second trumpet and the second flute have. How many of you hear the flute? No, you do. You all hear it, I assure you. Let's do it without Don, do it without the flute. Now add the flutes. Again, that's the genius. The overtones change in the whole hall. When we did this last night, I'm just like, oh, it's just amazing that he would think of that, and it's such a unique call. The other, that's it, I guess. I want to really thank the chorus. Roger mentioned the three choirs. We actually have representatives, I think, of almost eight choirs in Southeast Iowa, and these are people that love to sing. Two rehearsals, and we're ready to go. We performed last night and had a wonderful time. I'm going to ask Blair to come out and conduct for you Hymn for the Fallen from the movie Saving Private Ryan. Thank you. The next piece on the program is another piece that I didn't know John Williams even wrote this piece. When I started working in programming, I go to YouTube and some music companies and listen to recordings, and I just typed up a list and I said everything that John Williams wrote. I can't even tell you. I mean, it was hundreds and hundreds of pieces, and I was stunned. And I started going through, well, one of the pieces is a story about the slave ship, Amistad, if you remember that. It was an actual case where slaves took over a ship and sailed it into New England. And they expected to be free because there was no slavery in New England. It became a Supreme Court case. John Quincy Adams, one of my relatives, helped defend them. And they eventually, I'm actually not lying about that. Normally I'd be lying to you about this. Go ask my brother, he's much more honest than me. We're descended from the Adams. But anyway, at the end of the movie, there's a scene where the slave ship, they're headed back to Africa. And John Williams found this poem written by someone in West Africa called Dry Your Tears, Africa. Your children are coming home. It was actually written in English. So we had it, just because he never likes to do things the easy way, he translated it back into Mende, a dialect of Western Africa. And that's what you'll hear the orchestra singing. But you don't need to understand the words to get this feeling of celebration. And I'd say actually this is my favorite piece on the program tonight, just because I didn't know it and I consider it a gem. Dry Your Tears.
Thank you.
You know, it's funny, when I'm programming, sometimes if I think, okay, I've never heard this piece, what are people going to think the first time? So I took this around to some friends, and I put that recording on, non-musicians, basically, and they just said, geez, that is a really cool tune. And I've been back and forth with the chorus, because with two rehearsals, you tend to want to look at your music. If you have four rehearsals, you can look up more. And it's such a pleasure to have a group like this to work with and to put that much spirit into it. It's really rewarding. So why did I have a chorus? It wasn't because of that piece, and it wasn't because of Into the Fall. I heard the next piece, and I'm just like, dang it, I've got to have a chorus. Because I have never heard this piece from Star Wars, or what you think? Star Wars. It is Star Wars, not Star Trek. Star Wars, The Phantom Menace. And I've heard this piece, and I'm just like, this is completely primal. And what he does is he takes this story. He's, you know, Williams was completely fired up to be working on this music from all the Star Wars movies. I mean, obviously the guy loves what he's doing. So he's thinking about incorporating a vocal background into this climactic sword fighting scene called Duel of the Fate. And he found this Celtic poem called The Battle of the Trees. He discovered a translation which appeared in the book The White Goddess. He was captivated by this particular stanza. Under the tongue root a fight most dread, while another rages behind in the head. This seemed to be kind of mystical and ritualistic and very appropriate to accompany this great sword fight scene. And then again, he doesn't want to do things the easiest way. He took this and translated it into Celtic, and then he tried Greek, but he didn't like the sound. So he went to Harvard Scholar and he had it translated into Sanskrit. So those of you that speak Sanskrit, you can check our pronunciation as we go along. So I guess he hated upper violins and the choruses, basically. One spot I do want to demonstrate just a little bit to you. So you hear how we broke this up. This is at 57 Orchestra. Our first group, flute, oboe, clarinet, trumpet, violin, and viola. So it's this frantic ostinato figure. Can you say that word with me? Ostinato, that repeated pattern. Now I said last night, I wasn't a particularly good music student, so I'm not positive that's what ostinato means, but I like having the crowd say it. So the second group has a different group, cello, bass, piano, percussion, trombones, and bassoon. Yes, that's the high IQ group in the orchestra that has taken that on. Now he has, Keith, I'm joking. Okay. Now he has the third group, which is the chorus, and he reinforces them with the horn section. Now we stick all of that together, and this is why I call it primal. This is called Duel of the Fates. before the final piece, I really want to thank you. It's great to have an audience like this, a great crowd. We're very appreciative of you coming out. We hope you continue to do so during the season. We try to make our concerts interesting and fun and high quality and fulfill our mission on a variety of levels, both for the musicians up here, the choirs, and you as an audience. I want to always thank the musicians from the orchestra. We pull musicians from about a 90-mile radius. It's a very good deal. Kirksville, Macomb, Cedar Rapids, Iowa City, Oskaloosa, and everything in between Davenport. It's really a privilege to be able to conduct it. The final piece on the program is the music from the extraterrestrial ET. This is the only piece on the program that really he took a section of the movie itself, the movie score, as the bicycles at the end of this are gaining velocity to escape from Earth. It's from a 1982 movie. Part of what makes the piece special is how he puts these rhythmic changes into the music, and you don't even notice it because of the excitement it generates. Here's what this rhythmic figure is at the very beginning. Let's do it one more time, and I'll show you the count. Two, ready. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, one, two. So he's doing these very quick major changes, but you don't care, do you? Now, part of that is, he takes that same rhythmic change, he puts a brass choir with it. This is at bar 14 where the brass come in. If we add that same rhythmic excitement underneath it with that ostinato, I don't know if that's fair to call it that again. Here's what it sounds like. Adventures on Earth from 1982, E.T. Thank you.
gentlemen, for coming tonight. We hope you've enjoyed the room. And if you didn't, talk to somebody else. And don't forget, we'll see you at the Capitol Theater on October 21st for Beethoven's Fourth Piano Concerto. Thanks again, and good night.